Good afternoon. This year's State of the City has a much different feel from last year. Winnipeg has weathered a storm, but slowly we are beginning to see light at the end of the tunnel. Today, I'd like to talk about bold moves. Now is the time for all of us to come together as a community, be bold, and help our economy recover. For our part, Economic Development Winnipeg's business development team has set some ambitious goals to support the creation of 10,000 more jobs and $350 million in capital investment over the next 5 years. Our tourism team is aggressively pursuing its support local campaigns, rebooking council events, and looking for new ones that will come to our city in the next 5 years with thousands of delegates who will get a chance to see what Winnipeg has to offer. Economic development is a long game, but what we do in the short game is what will give us the wins we need later. If we want to put down a strong foundation on which companies can stand on, grow, and succeed in a post-pandemic economy, we all need to take the support local concept to a whole new level. I'll show you what I mean. Take a look at this video. Winnipeg is a growing city, on its way to 1 million strong. But we've always been a community of builders, innovators, and leaders. And in good times and bad, we've come together to support local businesses when they need us. It's what we do. And we've taken pride in supporting Winnipeg companies that were built from the ground up, as they take the world stage with industry-leading creations and disruptive technologies. As we come out of this difficult period in our city's history, we all need to ask ourselves, what does support local really mean? At Economic Development Winnipeg, it's a key driver in everything we do. It means celebrating Winnipeg success stories. It means supporting government and industry partnerships to build innovative products that protect lives. It means connecting local companies so that they procure supplies and services from each other, working together to make our economy stronger. We support local companies every step of the way to grow their operations. We help global companies make a local impact. We build the ecosystem that grows our entire economy and makes our city a better place to live, work, and play. When we come together as a community to support local businesses, when they support one another, and when we create the right conditions for growth, our city thrives. We can all play a role to support local. What role will you play?
Good afternoon and welcome to today's event. My name is Sriraj Patel, Chair of the Winnipeg Chamber of Commerce and Vice President of Commercial Financial Services at RBC. On behalf of the Winnipeg Chamber of Commerce, I would like to acknowledge that we're gathered today on Treaty 1 territory, the traditional land of the Ojibwe, Cree, Oji-Cree, Dakota, and Dene Nations, and the homeland of the Red River Métis. Next week marks the first ever Anti-Racism Week hosted by the City of Winnipeg. It brings Winnipeg into a dialogue about eliminating systemic and institutional racism that has long harmed racialized communities throughout our city. Being anti-racist means delving deeper and finding the roots of racism embedded in power and policies and actively changing them. It means becoming comfortable having uncomfortable conversations. And it means recognizing while diversity is a fact, inclusion is a conscious action. COVID-19 has impacted all of us to varying degrees. There's no question that it has had a devastating impact on many, but it has disproportionately affected racialized communities in Canada. Our recovery offers us a chance to reimagine a different way of doing things. Informed by community collaborations, the Winnipeg Chamber of Commerce commits to engaging with governments, private and nonprofit sectors to ensure an equitable, inclusive local economy where businesses are truly inclusive. Before we get started, I'm pleased to welcome Chrissy Slater to lead us in a traditional drum song.
Thank you. The song I'm going to share with you today, it's called Under the Moon. It is a song composed by my sister, April. And thank you, everybody.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Chrissy. We are here today at the beautiful Forks with Winnipeg sign in our backdrop, and I can't help but wish we were together. A huge thank you to Inn at the Forks for allowing us to use your beautiful space for today's State of the City address. And for all those watching, please consider supporting our local hotels with various staycation options available in Winnipeg. What a year it has been. Here we are, a year since the pandemic made its way to our community. This past year has been a year of growth and innovation, but it has also brought upon hardships for many of our city's most vulnerable. Our city's small businesses, notably those in the downtown core, have been some of the hardest hit throughout the pandemic. Whether they had to close their doors, shift their business online, or a multitude of other pivots, they've been heavily impacted. For many of us, we have been apart from our family and friends for some time now, and there's an overwhelming need for us to come together again. Today, we're here with Mayor Brian Bowman for the annual State of the City address, where he'll reflect on Winnipeg's triumphs and challenges of 2020. In place of a keynote address, we've decided to do a fireside chat where Mayor Bowman will lay out his vision and priorities for our city moving forward. Today's virtual luncheon programming is set up to reflect your usual in-person luncheon experience. This is your opportunity to connect with your community and other chamber members, all from your home or office. If you have any technical issues today, please contact any of our chamber staff by chat on the right-hand side. They are listed as WCC Help under the attendee list. Before we welcome Mayor Bowman to the virtual stage, we'd like to thank our presenting sponsor, Bell MTS, our title sponsor, CN, CPA Manitoba, CPHR Manitoba, Economic Development Winnipeg, and Pipilato Law. Our networking sponsor, PCL Construction, our registration sponsor, CAA Manitoba, and our high school program sponsor, MITT. We appreciate you for your support. We'd also like to thank CTV Winnipeg for recording and broadcasting today's luncheon. Lastly, we would like to thank our chamber champions and chamber leaders who have stepped up and helped the chamber in providing events and supports to our members. Thank you for everything you do. We encourage you to get on social media to join in on the conversation using the hashtag WCCBiz. Okay, it's now my pleasure to introduce you to Ryan Clausen, Vice Chair of Bell MTS in Western Canada, to say a few words and introduce Mayor Bowman.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Ryan Clausen, and I'm the new Vice Chair of Bell MTS in Western Canada. And it is a great honor to be with you, my fellow Winnipeggers, to introduce our Mayor, His Worship Brian Bowman. We are pleased to sponsor the State of the City Address again this year, which is a welcome opportunity to hear the city's priorities for the next year while connecting with business and community leaders. If we didn't know it before, this year of challenge has proven that Winnipeg truly is the home of opportunity and hope, an inclusive and welcoming community, strong in innovation and entrepreneurial spirit, and unmatched in our citizens' willingness to give both of their time and their resources to help those around them. At Bell MTS, we're proud to be a major investor in Winnipeg today and into the future. Through our investments, we're unleashing new economic opportunities with the most advanced networks and service innovations for both consumers and businesses. And we've taken our support to the next level here in Winnipeg with the largest ever communications project in Manitoba, investing $400 million to completely rebuild Winnipeg's communication network with state-of-the-art fiber optics. This project is expected to deliver more than 1,100 jobs and an estimated $900 million in new economic activity, and is the largest single project in our billion-dollar Manitoba investment plan. Our customers are already seeing the benefits of recent investments in mobile and fiber networks that continue to keep Manitobans reliably connected despite the incredible demand for remote working and learning. We know Winnipeg is one of the fastest growing tech innovation hubs in the country, and we're building the network to fuel that growth through the challenges of today and into the economy of the future. We also know that building stronger communities goes beyond expanding our networks. The COVID-19 crisis has been difficult for everyone, but for people living with mental illness and the organizations that support them, it's been especially challenging. The social isolation and times of uncertainty are presenting new struggles for many families, and the need for frontline support is greater than ever. In January, the Bell Let's Talk Diversity Fund was proud to announce a $175,000 donation to Mosaic Newcomer Family Resource Network in Winnipeg. This donation supports trauma-affected newcomer parents and children to build awareness for mental health, resilience, and healing through culturally responsive programming. This is one of the many programs we support so that people living with mental illness are encouraged to seek help if and when they need it, without fear of stigma and discrimination, allowing them to lead happier and healthier lives today and into the future. We are proud to have collaborative partners like Mayor Bowman as we seize the opportunity to invest in our community and advance how Winnipeggers connect with each other and the world. This marks the mayor's seventh State of the City address since becoming Winnipeg's 43rd mayor in 2014. Both of Mayor Bowman's successful campaigns were focused on building Winnipeg for a population of 1 million people. Since Mayor Bowman took office, the city's population has grown from 695,000 to almost 767,000 residents. Mayor Bowman has put an emphasis on investing in city infrastructure, including historic investments in road renewal and enhancing the city's transit service, with the completion of the Southwest Rapid Transit Way. Through both terms, Mayor Bowman has been particularly focused in engaging the next generation of leaders. Through initiatives like the creation of the Youth Advisory Council, the Mayor's Scholarship for Community Leadership, and speaking at all of Winnipeg's high schools. Since taking office, the Mayor has also made reconciliation and the protection of human rights a central part of his efforts to ensure Winnipeg is a place we all can be proud to call home. He has led and continues to lead the city through a global pandemic while preparing it for recovery and continued growth. Please join me in welcoming the Mayor of Winnipeg, His Worship, Brian Bowman.
On Treaty One territory and the traditional homeland of the Métis, Winnipeg has gone quiet.
It's a time when many of us are feeling anxious
and concerned for each other.
But in Winnipeg, when a storm hits, we weather it.
We dig deep.
We build up.
We clean up.
And we stick together, even while apart.
No matter what kind of storm hits,
we remember where we come from.
And who we are.
We're a city who outworks everyone else.
We're a city of fighters.
And we're a city of champions.
We're so resilient, we create our own whiteouts.
And during these storms,
we support those on the front lines.
And we lend a helping hand to those that need it.
And as we battle a storm we've never seen.
A storm we can't see.
We'll do what we always do.
We'll weather the storm.
Winnipeg can weather any storm. And when this storm has passed, we'll be stronger than before.
Mr. Mayor, thank you for joining me here for a historic moment, the first virtual State of the City address. We just watched the video you released last spring, Winnipeg Can Weather Any Storm. It's been a difficult year for the world, our country, our province, and Winnipeg. How would you describe the impact of the pandemic on Winnipeg, and what have you learned about Winnipeg's ability to weather it?
Well, first, let me begin just by saying it's good to join you, Raj, and thanks to the Chamber for facilitating this. Let me also begin by offering our community's deepest condolences to the more than 600 families who have lost a loved one during this pandemic over the last year. Recently we held a very moving memorial right behind us, the Winnipeg sign, when we dimmed the lights and put a candle out for each of the Winnipeggers that we've lost. And, you know, what we've seen over the last year, you know, that video was filmed at the beginning of the pandemic. What we've seen over the last year should really inspire Winnipeggers in terms of how this community can respond during a time of crisis. We've seen the care and the concern that Winnipeggers are known for, And we've seen people really step up, especially the essential workers in our community. But we're not through the storm yet. You know, the battle continues. And at the City of Winnipeg, we continue to support the efforts of Manitoba Health and our provincial partners. It began early in the pandemic by supporting enforcement measures. More recently, we've been assisting as a municipal government with some of the logistics associated with the vaccination rollout. But what I would say to Winnipeggers is the way in which we're going to get through this storm quicker is by everybody that can getting their vaccine. And so what I would say to Winnipeggers is when you get the call, roll up your sleeve, get the vaccine. Not only will it help protect your own health, but it will help protect the health of our community, and it will get us back to normal or the new normal much quicker than we would otherwise.
We can all agree the health of our residents and well-being of the community overall is critical. At the Chamber, we also see firsthand the impact the pandemic has had on our local economy. Business owners and hospitality sector, including restaurants, bars, hotels, theaters, and entertainment venues, all their employees have borne a significant part of the economic impact as public health orders have either closed these businesses or restricted the travel and tourism that supports them. What has our city done to support our local economy?
No doubt this last year has been extremely difficult for local businesses. You know, the result of the pandemic, the provincial public health orders that shut businesses down has had a devastating impact on our local economy. Over the last year, I've had a chance to talk with a lot of the local businesses to hear directly from them about what the last year has been like. You know, we saw our unemployment rate rise to 9.1% in 2020, up 3.5% from the previous year. And we saw our accommodation and food industry lose 5,000 jobs. Construction industry lost 3,000 jobs. And so it has absolutely been an incredibly difficult year for so many in our community. You know, municipal government doesn't have the levers or the financial resources that other levels of government do, but we still tried to look within to see how we could help. And so some of the things we worked on over the last year included the 1-hour free parking downtown, additional loading zones to help facilitate curbside pickups in our downtown, and then citywide, the relaxing of the residential parking restrictions, recognizing that a lot of employees are and have been working from home. We also allowed the deferral of property and business taxes to give people more flexibility in that respect. But in the 2021 multi-year balanced budget update, we stepped up in a much more direct way. And so we introduced something called the COVID-19 Economic Support Grant Program. And what this has been doing is been giving businesses that were directly impacted by the COVID-19 provincial health restrictions $1,500 that they could use for rent and utilities and for staff salaries. The other thing that we did is we significantly increased the business tax exemption threshold. And what that has meant is, in effect, there's about 1,000 businesses in our community that are having the business tax fully refunded to them. This is on average about $1,900. And for those businesses that also qualify for the COVID-19 economic grant program, it's in addition to that $1,500. The other thing that we did is, and it was quite strategic, is we kept our capital spend whole. So this is the investments that the municipal government makes in building things. Roads is obviously a significant spend in recent years. And we did this for two reasons. Firstly, it provides that short-term economic stimulus and the jobs that's created along with it. You know, our overall six-year capital investment program is $2.3 billion. That'll generate revenues for other levels of government as well. The taxes that are ultimately collected by the provincial government are about $111 million from that investment. But the other reason we did it is it positions our economy for the recovery, and then it continues to build the city for the future, which is something that Winnipeggers expect of us.
Just as there have been serious impacts to residents and businesses in our community, governments have also been grappling with the financial and logistical implications of the pandemic. Especially as a provider of essential services, how has the financial impact on the city been managed, and what has the city learned in this process?
Well, I hope what Winnipeggers have been reminded is just how critical the essential services of a municipal government are. And we saw that during this pandemic. I'm talking about clean, safe drinking water, you know, wastewater, you know, garbage collection, 911 services. all of these services, were threatened in the beginning of the pandemic, and we had to really ensure we did everything we could to protect those essential services and the business continuity that Winnipeggers need and expect of a municipal government. The timing was interesting. I mean, we went into the pandemic having just passed the first ever historic accomplishment, the first ever four-year balanced budget. While other governments struggle to just balance one, under the leadership of Councillor Scott Gillingham, we balanced four. And so that positioned us as well as we could have going into the pandemic. But within weeks of having passed that multi-year balanced budget, we were already projecting a deficit due to non-recoverable COVID costs of almost $80 million. It's a significant sum. And so we worked to implement our COVID-19 crisis cash management plan. And what we did is we ultimately used the strategic use of debt within our debt policy, our debt ceiling, to preserve that capital spend. We reduced the cash to capital to make sure that the operational budget was left whole so that we could continue to offer those critical services to Winnipeg at a time they needed it. We also, of course, looked at the services that we were offering, and we had to look at how do we deploy services in a more innovative way. And so we moved to online meetings. We allowed for councillors and for members of the public delegations to come in remotely to our meetings. We accelerated our online permitting and our virtual inspections significantly. We offered curbside pickup, contactless holds and pickups at our libraries. And then we also activated open streets, something that most Winnipeggers, I think, really enjoyed. One of the main reasons we were able to really get through it, though, is thanks to the efforts of our federal partners. I added my voice on the national scene to advocate on behalf of municipalities for federal support. And our federal partners provided $74.5 million to the city of Winnipeg to help ensure that those critical services were able to continue. And so that's something that helps significantly.
Our next question comes from Jasdeep Devgan of CN, one of today's title sponsors.
Thanks, Raj. Hope you're doing well and staying safe. Let me start by saying that CN is proud to support today's virtual state of the city of Winnipeg. This past year has been one of unprecedented challenges, and we've all had to adapt to new realities to keep our communities safe. Over the last year, our entire CN team has been hard at work, continuing to deliver the essential goods we really depend on every day. And you've seen just how critical CN is to Canada's essential supply chains and keeping our economy moving even during global uncertainty. We've also been focused on directly supporting communities through this challenging period. Through CN's Winnipeg Community Board, we've proudly contributed over $250,000 to 26 frontline grassroots organizations, helping those most vulnerable in our community. And CN will continue to be a committed partner as we move forward together. So my question for Mayor Bowman is, we've talked a lot about the impacts of the pandemic on the community, businesses, and the city, and how we've managed to get through 2020. Given that we aren't quite done with the impact of the pandemic, what do you think the future looks like for Winnipeg?
Well, there's certainly going to be a new norm. We're not going to go back to the old ways in many industries, and also with the service delivery from governments. And so early in the pandemic, I revised the mandate letters for our committee chairs, as well as for the mandate letter for our deputy mayor, Councillor John Orlico. And what I asked of each of our municipal leaders is really to work collaboratively with the community and with the public service to examine changes that we're making during the pandemic that just make sense going forward. And so you can expect to see a re-examination of our remote council meetings and the ability for members of the public to appear in delegation over Zoom. That's something that I think has been really well received. I've certainly enjoyed that, and we've been hearing from a lot of people, and in some cases we haven't heard from before because of the accessibility that it provides. Our open streets has been very well received by most Winnipeggers, and we're already actively looking at how can we make some of these changes more permanent for the benefit of active transportation in our community? And then, of course, our on-request transit pilot. This was approved in the most recent budget update, but you can expect to see more examination of that service and utilizing technology better to the benefit of transit riders. The other thing that I've really appreciated, and I want to thank everybody in our community, is is the increased emphasis on supporting local. That's something that we absolutely need to continue on the other side of the pandemic. And what I'll just say is, weathering storms is in our DNA as a community. And that's something, whether it's the flood of the century, whether it's a blizzard, or in this case, a global pandemic, we get through it by leaning on each other and doing what we're known for. And that's the care and compassion that Winnipeggers show to each other throughout the year. And we will get through this storm if we work together.
Mr. Mayor, the visibility of civic government or City Hall has been amplified in recent years. We saw the critical role the city played in October 2019, storm that devastated the city's tree canopy. And this month you recognize 1 year of city's Emergency Operations Center being activated in response to COVID-19. There have been many big decisions governments have made and continue to make that have significantly changed the lives of Winnipeggers over this past year. Significant actions being taken that don't always appear to be coordinated between governments. What would you say to people who are frustrated when they don't see governments working together and about the role the city has to deliver the services it is responsible for?
Yeah, I mean, obviously collaboration is always key, especially for a municipal government. I mean, the reason I was attracted to putting my name forward to serve in municipal government is it's the level of government closest to the people, and it's the most accessible level of government. You know, our meetings are live streamed. Members of the public can appear in delegation at committee meetings and at meetings of council. I mean, can you imagine if that happened in the legislature or in parliament? It'd be a pretty different dynamic. And so, you know, we have obviously our 311 center is operational 24/7, and there's multiple points during a typical year where members of council are accessible to the public. And so it's a level of government that I enjoy serving in for that reason itself. And there have been examples where collaboration has occurred to the benefit of our community, and that's always key. I mean, the only way that municipal government can really get big things done is often through partnerships with third-party stakeholders and with other levels of government. And some of the examples where we've been successful at doing that include the Waverly Underpass. This was a project that was in my first term, and we partnered with provincial and federal officials and supported by their finances as well. And that's a project that the city led on and was ultimately on time and under budget. I think there was about $68 million of under budget savings that we realized. There's also the second phase of rapid transit. So the Southwest Rapid Transit Way, again, was a project supported by all three levels of government. And that came in $169 million under budget and on time. The next major project that we absolutely need the support of both provincial and federal governments is the North End Sewage Treatment Plant. It's estimated to be a $1.8 billion project. City of Winnipeg property taxpayers simply can't shoulder those costs on their own. And so, so collaboration is key. You'll know from my last State of the City address, I announced that for the first time ever, the Our Winnipeg planning document and vision would be guided by the UN sustainability goals. And that document now is out in public view, having gone through first reading at City Hall. You know, while we're the level of government closest to the people, and that Our Winnipeg planning document has been guided by substantive input from Winnipeggers themselves, unfortunately, our provincial government is going in the other direction with the introduction of Bill 37. This is a bill that's before the legislature that will ultimately give a group of individuals that have been appointed by provincial officials the ability to veto planning decisions made by local democracies and local councils. And so, you know, local councils are accessible. They're accountable to the residents that they serve and to voters. This is a group that will be politically appointed, will not be accountable, and so it really is a concern going forward. We want to make sure that that local democracy is ultimately successful, and you do that by making sure that the decisions are being made at the local level for the community that they serve. And so I'll call on all of our MLAs from the city of all political stripes to stand up for local democracy and help work with us to preserve that political accountability for the planning and the decision-making about our shared future.
Mr. Mayor, you've talked about collaboration with other orders of government to ensure community needs are being met, but those needs are changing as the city grows. In 2013, the year before you were elected, the population was 695,000, Last year, the city had grown to almost 767,000. One of your earliest commitments was to build Winnipeg for a population of 1 million people. How is that going and what is on the horizon?
Well, you know, the numbers speak volumes, and it really demonstrates that people have confidence in the direction that our city is going. I mean, tens of thousands of new Winnipeggers, new families choosing to build their future here with all of us as the city grows to 1 million people is incredibly encouraging. You know, in the previous campaigns, I talked a lot about the need to invest in some of our core infrastructure. And you know, of a $30 billion capital asset catalog, we have about $13 billion is roads. So 42% of our capital assets are roads. And so we've made historic investments in road repair. It's resulted from 2015 to 2020, it's resulted in over 800 lane kilometers of road renewal. That's the distance from Winnipeg to Thunder Bay. And it's more than double the outcomes in the previous 6 years. We also have before council right now the new transit master plan, which is looking at really modernizing a public transportation for a city of 1 million people. We've seen incredible investments in our downtown recently, and that's something I'm particularly proud of and grateful for those that are investing. Of course, we have investments like True North Square and Red River College's downtown campus investments, the Richardson Innovation Center. But we're also seeing a new skyline emerge with the Artist Reed Tower, 400 new units. It is the tallest building to be built in Winnipeg in three decades and will be an incredible asset for the future of our downtown. We also have, of course, you know, the market lands development. 3 years ago, I announced that I wanted to see the former PSB building demolished. Now we're actually looking at what's going to go in that space so that we can realize the investments that we want to see there. And we're looking at affordable housing and an arts component in there, which is incredibly exciting. There's also a couple key projects that we have a keen interest in, and we've supported one of them so far, which is the Portage Place development. Council has supported that. We're watching with great interest, and hopefully you know, we'll see that project proceed, but we're watching the discussions between the federal government and the developer right now. And then, of course, there's the Hudson Bay building. You know, we don't own the building, but I've convened a group of key stakeholders to have dialogue with Hudson Bay so that we can see what this community might be able to do with that space going forward. But it's not all just about downtown developments. There's other key investments and development opportunities that we want to unlock and realize those investments. One of which is out at the University of Manitoba, and it's the Southwood Golf Lands. Council has recently approved the secondary plan, and that's a way to really realize on the investment that Winnipeg has made in the Southwest Rapid Transit Way. It's anchored as a transit-oriented development project, along with many others along that corridor. And then, of course, there's the former Capion Barracks. We've been in dialogue for years with the Treaty One Chiefs and Canada Lands Company, and that's an incredibly important and, I think, exciting investment opportunity that we hope to see very soon in the city of Winnipeg. There's also other amenities. You know, there's amenities that Winnipeggers and tourists expect in a modern, large city. And so building on some of the world-class things that we have, like the Winnipeg Symphony Orchestra and the Royal Winnipeg Ballet, and, you know, behind us, the Canadian Museum for Human Rights and the Manitoba Museum and, you know, Journey to Churchill and the Assiniboine Park, there's new amenities coming online, and one that is very near and dear to my heart. I was former chair of the Winnipeg Art Gallery, and we were the first government in to provide support for Calmayork. And so this is formerly known as the Inuit Art Center. It's gonna open virtually next week. It's gonna be an incredible opportunity to display the world's largest collection of modernist Inuit art, but also it can act as a bridge culturally and economically with the North. And so it's very exciting. And then, of course, Canada's Diversity Garden at the Assiniboine Park is under construction, and we'll be looking forward to when that's opening as well. It isn't all about steel and concrete, though. We have to be mindful of a city that's green. And so our Million Tree Challenge, which we launched a few years ago, it continues to gain momentum. You know, we've had key corporate supporters like CN and Telpay. I'm very proud to announce that in their 100 year of existence, the Winnipeg Foundation has agreed to step up and contribute $1 million to the Million Tree Challenge. and want to thank them right now for stepping up in such a significant way. The idea with the Million Tree Challenge is if we can have every Winnipegger be responsible for planting one tree as we grow to a million people, we're going to ensure our tree canopy continues to grow and remain green for future generations. And so 2021 is a great year for Winnipeggers to plant a tree. And I'll just take this opportunity to invite Winnipeggers to join us as we build a million trees in our community in the years to come.
You mentioned investments in transit. We learned the most significant losses in the city's 2020 fiscal year were from transit. Back in 2014, you ran on a commitment to improve transit in Winnipeg. Funding those improvements has not been easy. What challenges have you faced in trying to improve transit over these past 6 years? And has your thinking changed with regard to how transit will look in the future?
My vision for a modern city includes a modern transportation system, and that's remained consistent over the years. What's changed since 2014 is we have a new provincial government with different priorities for public transportation. Notwithstanding that, we've made improvements. We've successfully completed the second phase of the BRT line out to the University of Manitoba, and that took the buy-in of all three levels of government. It includes a beautiful active transportation corridor, which if you haven't ever gone out and checked out, it's worthy of going out and enjoying it. It really is world class. We've also made other investments in transit, including safety enhancements. We now, for the first time ever, have a low-income bus pass, which is going to be phased in over multiple years. And we also are allowing children 11 and under to ride for free. There's also improvements that have been made to the Transit Plus system as well. But we now have, of course, the new transit master plan that has been proposed, and it's a significant step forward for those that want to see a modernized public transportation system. It has really a completely new network that it is better matching to the reality of the developments in our city. It will realize on the on-request transit pilot that was underway right now. And then, of course, the move to zero emissions is something that we want to see. And so it's a very exciting and very ambitious plan that is going to need politicians at every level to be courageous and have some vision to really plan for the future. And so what we want to do and what we all know that we need to do is we need to move our transit system to one that's been designed for your grandparents and during their generation to one for the next generation. And we have a plan. Fortunately, we also have available dollars that are earmarked for Winnipeg Transit. The federal government has a transit stream. It has over $200 million that's sitting in Ottawa right now, just waiting to be used by Winnipeg Transit. We obviously need to review as a council, but we're going to need the support of our provincial and our federal officials. Combined all in, we have about $500 million that should be available to support the implementation of the Transit Master Plan. And that will be a part of the dialogue this year. We're going to need the support of our provincial government to support it and also, of course, make the application on our behalf to the federal government. So you can expect to hear more from me on that as we go forward.
Those basic core services such as transit are essential for Winnipeggers and are critical to supporting a growing population to get to work, study, and to go about day-to-day life. But the reality is, the needs of our most vulnerable Winnipeggers are more complex, especially those experiencing and at-risk homelessness, families and individuals faced with the challenges of addiction or mental health issues. What is the city doing to ensure no Winnipegger is left behind?
Yeah, I mean, you're right, Raj. I mean, these are complex issues. Municipal government really is that safety net when the support systems and the outcomes aren't being delivered effectively by other levels of government. And so, when individuals are in need, they call municipal government, they call 911, and we answer the call. Unfortunately, we only have really three dispatchable options when someone calls 911. We have fire, paramedic, and we have police. And far too often, individuals need other services. And so one of the things that we've been exploring through the Bloomberg Harvard initiative that's been supported by council is a fourth dispatchable option to better connect individuals with the support they need at the right time. The other thing that we're doing is increasing our partnerships with the community. And so the Downtown Community Safety Partnership is something that has also been supported by our provincial partners and is introducing services, including, among other things, the Connect team. And so Winnipeggers will have seen the Connect team downtown, and they're already making a positive difference trying to connect people to the services that they need. The other thing that during the pandemic I think has been more visible for Winnipeggers is our unsheltered Winnipeggers, or Winnipeggers that are affected by homelessness. And you know, in a country as wealthy as Canada, we shouldn't have homeless. I mean, we are a wealthy country. We need to do better as a nation and as a community. And so fortunately in Winnipeg, we have an organization called End Homelessness Winnipeg, an organization that our city council in the previous term supported, and we continue to support, along with other levels of government who have within their core jurisdiction issues of mental health, housing, among other things. And so we've been working through End Homelessness Winnipeg to really better focus on outcomes. The last street census had about 1,500 Winnipeggers affected by homelessness. I want to see that number go down, and I want to see the 10-year plan to end homelessness realized. And so all levels of government are increasing their dialogue and their collaboration. We've been bringing officials together more recently, and we'll be pushing each other and, of course, End Homelessness Winnipeg to really identify for us what we can focus on for outcomes. I would like less announcements about funding, more announcements about outcomes. The funding is important as long as it's directed and coordinated properly. And so some of those announcements recently by provincial and federal officials have been encouraging. The federal government has stepped up in a major way with the Rapid Housing Initiative, which has brought in $12.5 million for housing in our community on top of other investments. But you mentioned in your preamble the complex needs of our residents. And when it comes to mental health and addictions, they're not easy issues. They're issues that really require all levels of government to work more effectively together. And that's why I created the Illicit Drug Strategy Task Force that brought together all three levels of government. We've begun implementing it with some of the 24/7 safe space monies that we've made available to groups like Spence Neighborhood Association and Gani Ganichuk. We've also worked collaboratively with our provincial partners. You know, the provincial government requested the transfer of the Vimy site in support of the Bruce Oak Recovery Center. I was really proud that council answered that call and did ultimately transfer the lands to the provincial government. And so, you know, the need for addictions supports in our community continues, and this is one step in the right direction. The other thing that I've said in previous State of the City addresses is that I don't want to see the city of Winnipeg as a municipal government get in the way of supervised consumption sites popping up in the city of Winnipeg where the data and science supports it. And so we're asking for that data and science to come forward through an administrative report for council's consideration. I would like, and my preference would be, for more robust and less ideological debate on this issue at the legislature. You know, this is the level of government responsible for health, but we're gonna do what we can to facilitate the dialogue and not get in the way, if I have my way, not get in the way of a site or sites opening in the city of Winnipeg. I see these things through a health lens, and there's far too many of our residents who have health needs that are not being met right now. And so there's more work for us to all do as a community and all levels of government.
Mayor Bowman, you have long been an outspoken defender and promoter of human rights issues. One of your biggest commitments in 2018 was your pledge to make Winnipeg a city for human rights. That's a big global subject with a lot of systemic challenges to tackle, and they reach into our workplaces, neighborhoods, and government. Tell me how you feel we are doing. What more is being done to truly make the city for human rights?
Well, you know, our human rights work and the dialogue throughout our community has been amplified in recent years, and that's a good thing, and that's something we obviously want to continue to support. You know, I reflect back to 2015 when that McLean's article came out that branded Winnipeg the most racist city in Canada. You know, we could have argued about the headline, but I'm actually really proud of how the community responded. I think we responded with honesty, and we used it to redouble our efforts to do better as a community. And so since that time, you know, in 2015, we held the National Summit for Racial Inclusion at the Canadian Museum for Human Rights. We partnered with the Canadian Museum for Human Rights. I created my Indigenous Advisory Circle, a group that continues to provide me with invaluable advice throughout the year. In 2016, we held the Year of Reconciliation, which had numerous events throughout the community. And then in 2017, we created the first ever Indigenous Accord. So this is the Winnipeg Indigenous Accord. I know the Chamber is a member. I'll take this opportunity to encourage others that are watching today's State of the City to really join us in our journey of reconciliation, learn more and join as a partner to Winnipeg's Indigenous Accord. You know, over my first term, I had the benefit of learning from so many people that have been doing work in human rights for many years. And organizations like, of course, the Arthur Murrow Center for Peace and Justice at the University of Manitoba, the Manitoba Human Rights Commission, and the Canadian Museum for Human Rights, among many others that are doing great work in the community. And I've increasingly seen our reconciliation work under that umbrella of human rights protection, because ultimately our reconciliation work is all about just respecting each other and demonstrating in action the dignity that all Canadians deserve. And so that's something that the National Centre for Truth and Reconciliation has certainly educated me and other Canadians about. And so when I was running for re-election in 2018, I campaigned on trying to elevate our human rights work in the community, to try to make Winnipeg a leader for the protection and promotion of human rights. And since that time, we've created the first ever Human Rights Committee of Council, the first of its kind in Canada, as far as we know. And out of that committee, we've acted on a number of things. One, we created the Newcomer Welcome and Inclusion Policy, and that policy work has been incredibly important. You know, out of our reconciliation training that we launched for all employees in the previous term, the Newcomer Welcome and Inclusion Policy talks about a city without racism. Out of that, we have launching on Sunday the first ever anti-racism week in the city of Winnipeg. And so we're asking Winnipeggers to consider what Winnipeg would look like without racism. And it's a hard thing to imagine for many Winnipeggers, and it tells us why we really need to continue to do that work. I'll be introducing, and I can announce today, I'll be introducing a motion at next week's Human Rights Committee of Council asking the city of Winnipeg to consider implementing and creating a diversity, an equity, diversity, and inclusion policy and strategy so that we can really better put a lens on our employees, to make sure that our employees and our employment hiring practices and retention practices better reflect the community that we serve. And so you can expect to hear about that next week when I introduce the motion. And of course, we've introduced recently the ability for permanent residents to serve on our boards and commissions, something that previously was restricted to Canadian citizens only. All of this work is incredibly important because we want to make sure that Winnipeggers know and feel in their hearts that they're respected, that they're getting the dignity that all Canadians should come to expect. And we want to make sure ultimately every Winnipegger and all those Winnipeggers that have recently moved here feel that Winnipeg is a place that they're proud to call home.
One last question, Mr. Mayor. In October 2020, you announced that you would not be seeking a third term, noting you entered public service to make a difference, not make a career. Subsequent to the announcement, you have reiterated that your commitment to Winnipeg and the role of mayor remains as strong today as it was on day one as mayor. Speaking to Winnipeggers today, please share your thoughts on the decision and the next 18 months.
Well, thanks for the question, Raj. I mean, I think hopefully this discussion has demonstrated there's a lot of work underway. And so working alongside my council colleagues in the public service and Winnipeggers, we've got a lot of work to do in the next year and a half, and I'm looking forward to leading those efforts. You know, I announced that I wasn't going to run again because, while it has been and continues to be a tremendous honor to serve Winnipeggers and the community that I love, I think Manitoba has too many career politicians, and I don't want to be one of them. So I'll look to my next steps of getting back to my career or doing something else where I feel I can make a difference in the community. But elected life is, I think, you know, the role of a lifetime and the best political office to serve in is Winnipeg's mayor. It has and continues to be an honor, and you can expect to see me working, hard right to the end of the term.
Thank you, Mayor Bowman, for sharing with us your vision and goals for our city moving forward.
Thanks, Raj. My pleasure.
Before we wrap up today, we have a video message from our title sponsor, Pipilato Law.
Big sigh. These are extraordinary times, and it seems like nobody can even remember what it was like before COVID. Everybody in this firm, in this city, in our community, in the world has been impacted by it. And it has left us having to deal with stress of varying degrees on a daily basis.
Over Pipilato's history, its key to success, I'd say, is its ability to build relationships with its clients. They are more than clients to us. We are a part of their team, and we are their trusted advisors.
First and foremost, we recognize the speed at which the world was changing around us. We knew that our clients needed information and communication. So in response, we created a COVID-19 resource center. It acted as a toolkit for our clients to rely on to help them make the decisions that they needed to make. Also, internally, we adapted. We embraced working from home, new technologies, a new way of carrying on business.
I have nothing but admiration in the team here at Pipilato. I always had the utmost faith that they would, as they always do, rise to the occasion in order that we could do what we do, which is help our clients and provide services to our clients.
Our United Way campaign this year just concluded, and obviously it was different this year than it normally is in that it was a virtual campaign.
Pleased to say that we not only met our fundraising goal, but we crushed it.
If there ever was a year when the United Way needed resources, it was now.
To all of Pipilato's clients, I'd like to thank you for your continued confidence in our firm. And of course, we'd like to thank all of the frontline workers and all of our staff at Pipilato for chipping in and working hard during this very difficult time.
Relationship, respect, results. It's the way we treat each other and the way we treat our clients. We believe in them and we live them.
That is all the time we have for today's Fireside Chat. Thank you so much for joining us today. I know I say this each time we close out a virtual event, but I'm looking forward to a time when we can gather together as a community again. Before we conclude though, I want to invite you to a special upcoming event. Our annual Civic Leaders Dinner will be held virtually on April 15th. It is your chance to connect directly with Mayor Bowman and other civic leaders from City Hall. Join us for a special night of meaningful conversations about our city and our community. Tickets are $25, the proceeds from which the Chamber is donating to Hama York, the Winnipeg Art Gallery's new Inuit Art Center and first of its kind in the world. Register your spot today at winnipeg-chamber.com. Thank you again for attending today's State of the City Address. Have a wonderful rest of your day and stay safe.